Welcome to the 19th hole. We have finished the course. The 18 holes finished the course, and now we're at the 19th hole. This is where the party is. Guess who's throwing the party? Our teachers. Our teachers are throwing a great big party for us. The ones that have, who have truly accepted a repentant mind. The teachers are absolutely delighted. Are you kidding? They've been working so diligently for so long to get some graduates. And so the harvest is in, and they say, wow, you know, let us have a super mega celebration and toast the graduates. So they're going to throw a big old party for us. Now, I was driving along, and I saw this crowd going somewhere. And where was it going? It was going to a graduation ceremony at this park, a public park. I said, I've never seen that before. It's unusual. But they decided this is a venue they wanted to put it in. It's a beautiful setting. Why not? Well, where's our party going to be? Well, you know, it might not even be in this world, actually. It's up to them to choose the venue, I think. We'll see. There may be some preparations for this big party in this world, and we may go through those preparations. But there's nothing that our teachers are more delighted in than our graduation, because that's a reflection upon them and all the work that they've done. So they're really paying homage and celebrating their own success in guiding us and helping us to liberation from the idea that anything needs to be liberated, right? So we're the guests of honor. We're the graduates. You know, the party gets thrown for the graduates. It's similar in the world. Parents throw big parties. If you make it through, this is an inducement. If you make it through and graduate and you do well, and then there's a big party waiting for you. This is the way that adults should treat young people growing up when they reach a certain stage in their life and they've made it through. Have a big party, celebrate it, and let them know that, hey, we really appreciate all your efforts. It's not easy. So I didn't get that type of situation. That's not part of a tradition I grew up in. But so it's all backloaded to this party. All the parties backloaded to this party. So we better prepare for this party. The 19th hole is upon us. Where, having finished the round of golf, now we're done. We don't, no more worried about how do I play this hole, play that hole. Just forget about it. We did it. We finished it. And moving on to bigger and better experiencing, that is for sure. How I found this banner is a total miracle. Today I was praying for help from all the bodhisattvas, the Dharma kings, Holy Spirit, and it was just amazing how it happened. Hard to believe. Holy Spirit said, look here, there's a pile of rubbish, look here. I was about to leave, and somebody walked up to the pile and started looking. And I said, what are they looking at? Maybe they're seeing something. So I went to talk with them. He said, oh, yeah, there's lots of little things in here. You see this. And I said, I don't see anything. And suddenly something caught my eye, just a piece of fabric or something. I said, I don't know. I think I saw like a part of it. I just pulled it out a little bit. I saw a 19. I said, what does that mean? Pulled it out. Oh, my gosh. 19th hole banner. I just said, this is extraordinary, because it's a confirmation. I was asking for confirmation, and the 19th hole, of course, is confirmation. You've finished the course. Keep in mind that Jesus said the purpose of A Course in Miracles is to make itself obsolete, make itself unnecessary. And I realized that today. I realize that all these teachings now have like become obsolete and unnecessary, and that's the whole purpose of them. So we're at the 19th hole now. So this is what we're preparing for, the 19th hole. Get this into your consciousness. This is in front of you, a party being thrown in your honor. Party being thrown in your honor for the ones who have repented, repentant mind, who have worked on repentant mind, Now, there are other miracles that took place today. Many, as a matter of fact. I drove into this place, got out of my vehicle, started walking, and I suddenly saw these flowers right beside me. I just like, what? What is that? It's astonishing. It's the most beautiful flowers I've ever seen in my life. There are so many of them, I've never seen them before. It came from a very ugly plant, a cactus-like plant, succulent cactus-like plant. But these flowers were just astonishing. And I said, I'm going to take some pictures of these. So I took a video of them, and you'll see those eventually in some video. But wow, they kind of look like a lotus flower, pink lotus flower, but just so dashingly beautiful, and so many clumped together too. It was just a sublime experience. In what was otherwise just a wasteland. I mean, it was just the pots, the plants, ugly scrub, nothing. It yet the jewel of these flowers, just a tremendous jewel-like ambience to the flowers. This is after I bring to Longchenpa for confirmations. He gave me so many confirmations today, and this is one of them. It's like these bodhisattvas are like his grace is like this jewel. This his court is like this jewel. All these beautiful flowers in this barren wasteland, desert land of worshiping time, which is also worshiping death and aging and sickness and misery and suffering and conflict and despair, depression, conflict, everything terrible. What a wasteland it is, and yet these flowers suddenly show up. I asked the people, have you seen these? And no. I don't know what you're talking about. I want to see. And someone said, oh yeah, I walked past them, but I gotta go out and check them again. I said, well, and someone came out and checked them and just said, oh my gosh, you look like water lilies. I said, yeah, like lotus flowers. Yeah. Diamond mine, the lotus mine. The lotus diamond mine. Set the stage. We are called to sobriety right now. The key to these times is to remain calm. Underplay it. Err on the side of caution in terms of just underplay it. Okay, Ferrari's in my driveway, that's fine. Now, I'll go sit in it. Okay, I'm sitting in it. That's fine. Just don't think about the future. And practice in this way. I leave all pending situations, pending in every which way, I leave all those just as they are, without an iota more work on any of it. And just shift my attention to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. I leave everything in whatever state of resolution it is, I leave it exactly like that. So I'm starting to, this is sinking in more and more and more and more and more. This is like crossing a bridge or taking a leap. This little leap we take. Including, I leave all my clarifications exactly as they are and just set it all down and just shift my perception over to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. So whatever mental clarifications we had, whatever progress we've made on the spiritual path, I leave that also. I leave it exactly as it is this very moment. All the clarifications, all the work I've done in which way, I leave all of those conclusions, efforts, whatever's pending to be clarified, I leave them all exactly as they are. Unfinished business. I leave all this unfinished business exactly as it is, this without an iota more of work on upon it. And just shift to this new form of perception, which is clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Now, there can be some commentary when I'm ready, it's necessary on this, but we don't need to force it. I leave everything just as it is. All my progress, unresolved. It's like, the trouble is, we can get to the edge, the very edge of enlightenment. And we keep doing that over and over. In fact, I've been doing that my whole life. And yet we never go any further. It's just, we get to the edge of it, we get a glimpse, but that's it. We're stuck on this ledge, stuck on the edge. So we leave ourselves just stuck on the ledge there. Okay, leave all our efforts that led us to being right on the edge. We just leave that on the edge. We don't take that into enlightenment or everything. Everything has to be left just as it is. And then just shift into clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. This is a new perception. So we'll never, with the old perception, we will never be able to perceive ourselves being enlightened. Just get up to the edge of it. The problem with stimulants is they can get us to the edge, but then we don't know what to do. This is a big problem. Only great sobriety is able to finally recognize that this shift that has to take place. So again, I've warned and warned and warned and warned against the sex, the drugs, the rock and roll. Sure, they'll get you to the edge over and over and over and over again. And yet still, there's all this unclarified, okay, now, what do I, how can I, you know, what did I, just leave all of that unclarified, just as it is. Just whatever motions taking place, it doesn't matter. We just set it down and shift over to the perception of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. We just shift to that. So some of us have been getting to the edge our whole lives, over and over again. Every day, we almost there, almost got it, almost there, almost got it. From there, it takes great discipline and patience to calm down. And humility to just realize, hey, whatever I've attained or not attained, I just leave all attainment exactly as it is, attainment and non-attainment, exactly as it is. Without trying to get another foothold anywhere. And then just easily shift to this new perception of a clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. So we have this practice now, and we don't have to expect immediate results. We can just keep practicing, and it's getting better. I'm seeing more and more. See, oh, clearer and clearer and clearer. Oh, that's how it's done. So These practices might take a couple weeks, a month before you really bears the fruit. That's fine. At least we have the practice. Super practice. So we leave our agedness, our infirmities, everything exactly the way they are. Don't try to make any alteration to anything that we're experiencing. Don't do anything whatsoever to it anymore. In this very instant, we let it go just as it is, like a balloon. We release it. We just let it go. So imagine we're holding a balloon, and it's got helium in it, or whatever, and we finally just open our hands and just let it go. Just let it go. If we want to get that balloon back at some time, we can, and it will be the same balloon. Same agedness, infirmity, sickness, the whole ball of wax will be there. But for now, just open our hands and let it go. So just imagine doing that. Not giving one more bit of judgment to any of it. So I'm letting go of all judgment, letting go of it. Imagine doing that. Just imagine. Letting go of sensory perception and all conclusions we've ever drawn. All efforts we've ever drawn based on sensory perception and even thinking about it or not about it or trying to think past it or whatever. Just let it all go. No more conclusions being drawn whatsoever. No improvements being made. No remodels being made. Just let the whole thing go all at once. Now you might not get such a big experience out of it, or maybe you do. That's okay. Just keep doing it. Keep focusing on this practice. How do we want the Dharma kings to find us? We want them to find us by practicing a super, super high practice. So you want to attract their attention, keep practicing. We can just say their practices, leaving everything just as it is. All disturbances, all peacefulnesses, all plans, all hopes and fears. All thoughts, all labels. Just leave it exactly as it is. With not the slightest even touch or breath of change in it. Not even the tiniest breath of change in any of it. So just in the instant, then we're in the instant, in this instant, we let it go. Just just let it go in this instant. That's all we have to do. Because the Holy Spirit will see to it that the new perception will dawn upon us. I had a dream last night. I got out of some basement. I've been in this wandering this basement forever, it seems like. All these amusement rides and kiddie merry-go-rounds and kiddie, you know, kiddie stuff. I said, finally, I witnessed to somebody. I said, look, what am I about? I'm about repentant mind. You have to have repentant mind, and you have to get liberation. I was talking to these older people, these adults, and I was insisting upon it. And then, like, I was supposed to be in charge of them or something, and somehow they vanished. Gone. I couldn't find out where they were. And then a friend was with me, also had vanished, and people just vanished. And I found myself walking up this corridor up into the upper room, which was ground level, where everything else was underground. And there's all these people just hanging out up there, and it was this beautiful glass like airport building where you could see everywhere through the glass. And the landscape was very flat and calm, and it looked like the dawn, looked like the light with this rosy light in the distance. Like it was, this beautiful dawn was there, and there were these many people there who were just kind of standing quietly, maybe saying a few words to one another. And I look at the dream, I realize these are the ones who have dropped everything, left everything just as it is in this basement of sensory perception, and just walked up. Imagine there's like an amusement park. The carnival comes to town, and you decide to leave the carnival. You've had enough, and you just leave everything the way that it is going on there. Just doesn't matter, you know. The carnies are barking, people are tossing these rings and balls and eating cotton candy and going on the Ferris wheel and doing all these rides and stuff. But you just walk away from it. It's just whatever's happening there. For me, I let it be just as it is when I left it, just as it is, and doesn't, nothing matters anymore about it. And you walk away from it. So it's like that. We walk up and we see the dawn. We're experiencing the dawn. The dawn of the new perception. It's dawning upon us. The new perception is dawning upon us. Keep in mind, everyone has this in their driveway already. Everyone already has this. It's just that you have to accept it. You cannot try to integrate it and use it as a tool to change sensory perception and to change what's happening there. We don't try to fix or change anything. Now, I'm so into this situation, Longchenpa's return, and the Dharma King's return. I forgot all about the NBA Finals are starting. They're playing right now, Golden State Warriors. I've completely forgot about it. Someone reminded me, but I completely forgot about it. That's being into it, okay? Because that's what everybody's talking about tonight. For me, my consciousness was not there at all. I said, I'm on this graduation thing. Now, can we do this? Yes, we can. I feel we can do this. We will do it. I can do it. I will do it. I've already done it. So instead of healing the world, here's an example. Let's say you have some affliction on your body, you sprained ankle or, you know, cut or whatever. Instead of praying for the cut to be healed, just say, no, leave the cut exactly as it is in sensory perception. And let me just shift to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. And in there, I just choose to see it as perfect. Okay, do you see the difference there? This is the fundamental difference. So, without healing anything more, without even engaging in any more healing efforts, just shift our perception to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, where everything is just seen as this spontaneous display. And if you want to see your this body in a flawless condition, That's the display. Spontaneously, that's the display you see. You see whatever you want to see. There's no, nothing fixated, nothing crystallized. You realize there's no crystallization, no fix. And so you say, well, what do I need healing for? I just instantaneously, if for one thing, it's all display, so the cut doesn't bother me at all. I don't even feel it. It's just display. But if we want to fit in, then we'll just, okay, like Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma having this hideous metastasized cancer in all parts of her body just instantly disappear. Instantly disappear, and she's fresh as a daisy. Easy. Any of us can do this. She refused all healing modes. She said, no, no, no. She said, I'm different. I'm a different situation here. I don't need any healing. I don't need pills. I don't need medicines. I nothing like that. When the display is set to change, and when it's time for me to, I decide, it's not me deciding, but when the grace of God decides, okay, this is the now display that we'll see now, boom. That's the display. She gets bit by a cobra, and the fang marks disappear. Boom. Gone. She drops dead like a corpse, rotting corpse, and then suddenly is fresh as a daisy again, hops up, and everything's perfectly well. Just display. We choose what we want to see. It's just light. Light responds instantly to us. We're pretending that it doesn't, that it has to go through what we call process, time, space, process, form. It doesn't. It's fact, it never has. It never has. Light has never tasted of time or space or process or form at all. None of that actually exists. Well, those are some good kids. They're not watching the game. They're out there practicing. Wow. See, that's the mind of a child, isn't it? It says, hey, I'd rather go out and play basketball than watch it. Super. Because they're playing and experiencing their own creativity, aren't they? Instead of just passively being force-fed. And of course, all the junk that surrounds it, the commercial junk and all this stuff. So I'm not watching it right now. I mean, I may, you know, bow to the expedient, you know, the when in Rome, do as Rome do. A lot of people are saying that. I asked them. I say, "Oh yeah, well, I couldn't catch it. I'm too busy." This is a response. A lot of hardened sports fans actually right now they're admitting, say, "Well, oh yeah, yeah, the Sharks. I didn't catch the game. I caught a little bit, but I was too busy." So a lot of people are just catching a little bit just to say they watched it, but actually they're not really watching anymore. A lot of guys are not watching for probably the same reasons I'm not watching, or similar reasons. Had enough of this nonsense. Very, very interesting, the shifting tides in the world. But we don't care about the tides. We leave the tide exactly as it is. And we might think again, like, can I do this? I believe we can. I believe we can if we just practice. I think someone asked Rama Maharshi, I can't, my thoughts, they seem to be in control of me. I don't think I can do this. Like, is it possible? And Rama said, just practice and you will find success. It will come to you. It will come to you. So we just practice, be committed that, yeah, I'm just setting everything down exactly as it is this very instant without any more effort to modify anything. All efforts at modification have simply been dropped. Of course, sensory perception gives a picture of modification, of everything is constantly being modified, whereas a vision of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness gives a picture of everything is being completely unmodified in its intrinsic abidance and in intrinsic spaciousness. There's no modification of that taking place at all. Zero. tired again today. Of course, the pressure's on. But leave your physical condition exactly as it is. However tired or aged you are, don't try to make any alteration or modification in any direction. 360-degree non-modification. I just accept this 360-degree non-modification right this instant. No more work on my image. No more work on my life, nothing like, no more. Keep practicing. And when Jesus comes, let him find you practicing. Let him find you doing this 360-degree detachment from modification. 360-degree detachment from any perception of modification. I give up all perception of all possible modifications. And instead, I just choose the perception of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. I just choose that. It'll be there automatically when we give up, when we detach from all potential modifications of any type. It's like flattening everything. Everything is absolutely flattened. I had that dream where I finally was able to flatten everything, and it was like tremendous success, but that was still just beneath the surface, you see. We're bringing this into the full surface consciousness now also. To be helpful. Leave everything just as clean and as dirty as it is right now. All the dust, just this will be the final perception, sensory perception of this world, just as it is, with the dust and the light this way and everything like this way. And then we see the world in a much more beautiful way and with a different meaning to it. So just trust in this, trust in it. Sure, we can explain and explain and explain, but leave all explanations unfinished. Otherwise, you'll be chasing explanations forever. So say, well, whatever I did to try and be enlightened, I just have to leave it. Leave it as it is. That's it. However far I got along the path, that's how far I got. And just leave it now. Now, I was just imagining this cleanup, and something fell down. I was cleaning up, and there was just like stairs going down to the down to a lower level, and some piece of wood, something fell off as I was cleaning up, went down the stairs. I said, "Oh my gosh, now I have to go get that." And I said, "No, no, no, leave it just as it is. Leave the whole cleanup effort just as it is. There's a scrap of paper there I didn't get. Leave it just, everything just as it is, what you cleaned up and what you didn't clean up." And then shift perception of everything. Shift perception of everything. Of course, perception is holistic, isn't it? I mean, when we shift perception, you know, it's like put on sunglasses, everything looks darker or whatever. So we shift perception to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness and see how we feel with that. And we've gone over this, you know, quite a bit, so we don't need to go over it right. If we keep going over it, we'll get stuck there. So what we have to do is practice actually just considering that I'm doing this. I can do this. I will do this. I've done it. I did it. I already did it. So imagine that you've successfully done this. As Jesus says, relax your mind, release your thoughts, and let them go. This is a shorthand way of what we're talking about here. Leave all the aspirations just as they are, however fulfilled they are, or unfulfilled that they are, however sick you are, however unsick you are, however well you are, leave all your well. If you're really well, leave your wellness exactly as it is. Leave your condition exactly as it is. This instant. And without any more effort whatsoever, zero, we then just shift right into the new perception of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Now, if this wasn't possible, I don't believe I'd be, you know, talking about it. You wouldn't be listening to it. I absolutely believe it's possible. And leaving all thoughts of whether it's possible or not, just as they are, we shift into clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. So in other words, leave your unconvincedness, however much you're convinced one way or the other, just leave it just like that. Don't try to make it be more convinced or, you know, convince yourself anymore. Leave that too, just as it is. Leave the sporting contest just as it is, unfinished. Leave our focus on practicing this exactly as it is, too. Leave our practice exactly as it is. And shift our perception to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. This is the 19th hole. We leave the golf course just as it is and we go into the clubhouse. Not out on the golf course anymore. we leave our resolve exactly as it is, whether it's strong or weak or whatever. We just leave it, our resolve, exactly as it is, and make the shift. Leaving everything just as it is the shift. That is the jump. It's somewhat of a. There's some sort of deep reaction to this, you might call it fatigue, sleepiness. It's a different type of practice, isn't it? Everything else is trying to modify existence. We drop all attempts to modify it in any way and just see it in a different way, perceive it in a different way. And then see if there are any problems to work on from that angle of perception. We take the confidence of Longchenpa with us that there are no problems to work on from that perspective. This is why he's very helpful, being able to express his confidence to us in such a very concise, condensed manner. This is good. Mango lemonade. Wow. That is really good. It only could keep me awake here. Not so hot today. It's all hype. The weather's all hype these days. It's unbelievable. Yeah, okay, so it was like 94 today. Will be. We'll see it tomorrow, because it'll maybe go up to 98, 99. But it doesn't feel bad at all. Not at all. It's not like anyone's cooking, you know, we're all fine. So again, we're not in any hurry, because our whole thing is we drop wherever we're going and just right this moment see everything, the clear light vision, intrinsic spaciousness. This is the rebirth that Jesus talked about. This is being born again, plain and simple. Cat's out of the bag. Just keep working on deciding, making that decision, and allowing it. And say, I can make that decision. I will make this decision. I did make this decision. I did it. And now, where am I? The 19th hole. Hanging out, watching the dawn. That's all. So sensory perception has us just going cuckoo, right? Gotta travel here, gotta travel there. We just say, wherever we are, we just leave ourselves there as if we've gone into a sleep of dreaming. And so we just allow ourselves to dream. Whatever we want to dream, it doesn't matter. Now we just recognize ourselves. We're just dreaming. That's all. So we leave all dreams exactly as they are. We leave the dreamer dreaming. We don't try to stop the dreams, interrupt the dreams, modify the dreams. Don't try to do anything with the dreams. And we just stop dreaming. We just see everything as it is. Instead of viewing a dream, we have the clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. And everything appears as if it were just mere display, beautiful, spontaneous display everywhere. No center to anything, no center anywhere. Everything equally display. No goal-oriented process taking place at all. Goal-oriented endeavor. Goal-oriented attainment. Non-attainment is the empowering attainment of pure presence, pure perception, clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. suggest we just hang out with this practice like this. So we leave the status of the dreamer completely undetermined, indeterminate. We leave everything as entirely indeterminate, and now shift our perception to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, where everything is entirely determinate in terms of its abidance. There's no question about it at all. So there's nothing to determine, no goal to attain. It's already, everything's already as that. And they'll say, oh, so easy. So this is it. Why didn't I see that before? So we leave all dreaming, even dreams of enlightenment, all of that just as it is, without making any judgment whatsoever. No more further determinations whatsoever. Just step into the 19th hole. Just arrive. We just walk into the clubhouse. Leave all our teaching, all our mothering, exactly as it is this instant. Indeterminate. Leave it as indeterminate. How successful were we in raising the children? How successful was I at my job? How successful was I? Leave it all absolutely indeterminate. Just like this summer, how it just arrived just almost instantly. It was like before, it was like, is it spring? Is it winter? I mean, we don't know what it is. And then wake up and it's suddenly summer. It was like, I'm not sure what I am. I'm trying to determine what I am. Oh, I'm summer. The summer vision. At least here, that's how it happened. It was amazing. So leave everything absolutely indeterminate of what season it is, what era it is, what progress is going to be made, all as absolutely indeterminate. And then we become aware, we shift into pure, clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. Now, we leave our glimpses of clear light, intrinsic light vision of intrinsic spaciousness. We even leave all our experiences and coincidences, etc., just indeterminate also. Everything is indeterminate. We leave it there. And then we just shift into this 360-degree clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness, 360-degree. We leave all reactions as indeterminate. The whole bundle of what? Of indeterminateness. Is not our identity we've been living with one of simply indeterminateness? Or a hope to make reality determinate, an effort to make reality determinate, which itself is perpetually indeterminate because it's based on time, is it not? So reality is completely determinate in that it is entirely indeterminate. Anything we want, any moment, it is. So everything always is. So that's determinately indeterminate, you could say. And with what we've been going through is to try to make this determinately indeterminate indeterminately permanent, determinate, or determinately, yeah, indeterminately determinate. Yeah, reverse it. So leave all that effort, all the effort to make it determinate. Just leave it as it is, as indeterminate display, meaning it's display in the now, right now. There's nothing to be determined. The now is not in the process of determining anything. This is the apex approach, the Ati Yogin apex approach of Dzogchen, just like this. No approach. We leave all approaches indeterminate. We leave every endeavor under the sun indeterminate. Even the shining of the sun, we leave that as indeterminate. Is it shining? Is it not shining? We leave it as indeterminate. Nothing has been determined. Nothing at all has been determined about this world. Ultimately, right? We just leave it as just as it is. Without making any more effort to determine anything whatsoever. And we just go into pure experiencing of the perception of clear light perception of intrinsic spaciousness. This is now our experience. Where everything is intrinsically determined as indeterminate. Always. That's why if the body seems to have a cancer, then you can, well, that's not determinate. We just decide, okay, I want the display to look this way. And then it looks like free of cancer. But it's all still this equal, the same, the display is the same in its abidance in intrinsic spaciousness. Nothing changes that way. So this is not a practice that we try to rush or get excited about or anything. We just stay very calm, sober about it. Don't try to grasp anything. Of course, we're just letting it, everything, resolve into this perfect indeterminacy. So we're just getting our feet wet, our toes, our feet. That's all. Sitting on the edge of a pool, dangling our feet in the pool, and not thinking about, am I going to swim or not? No. We're just sitting here, around the pool of perfect indeterminacy, determinate indeterminacy. It's pure indeterminacy, pure freedom of display, of experiencing. And we're just dipping our feet in, and no pressure to jump in, anything like that. So we just detach from the so-called determinant identity. We think we've fashioned some sort of determinate identity. Well, we let that be whatever it is, indeterminate, an indeterminate determinate identity. We just let it be like whatever it is, whatever we think it may be or not, just don't try to make any further determinations at all. And whatever determinations we think we've made, we let those go too. We're not interested in any of that anymore. We call upon all the Dharma kings to help us out, and their all their grace to help us out with this, to assure our success of this practice, our rapid success of this practice. We ask them for the utmost confidence in this practice. Ask them for the utmost confidence in this practice. So we have this great assurance that indeed that we can do this, we will do this, we've already done it. We can do this, we will do this, we've already done it. Already done it. So our reaction to, yeah, Longchenpa's here, yeah, it's all gonna go down now, coming up, is to just practice this. Hang out gracefully, calmly here, simply practicing. What better reflection could there be upon our teachers than this? Teachers are saying, "I'm looking for my students. I know I can. I know who they are. I know who my sheep are. It's the ones that, even in this dire emergency crisis of the world, they're calmly practicing this. Let everything be exactly as it is, without trying to make any more determinations whatsoever. We simply shift our perception to clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness." They'll say, "Ah, there's my sheep." So whatever happens, let it happen, and just keep practicing like this. During the daytime, I kept coming back to this, kept coming back to this, kept coming back to it. That's a good sign. When you find yourself during the daytime being able to say, "Oh, I strayed away from it. Oh, let me bring myself back to it." That's a very, very good indicator that it's settling in. Don't think about it, just do it. Just imagine that it's done. You did it. I can do it. Instead of thinking, say, "I can do it, I will do it, I've already done it. I can do it, I will done do it, I've already done it." Don't let Jesus come back and see you thinking. He'll say, "What? What am I? Where's my sheep? That's not my sheep that is thinking, thinking, thinking. Be practicing, like practicing, practicing, practicing." I can do it. I will do it. I've already done it. How does that feel? Not, "What do I have to do? I'm trying to think about what I need." I can do it. I will do it. I've already done it. Let everything, whether it seem determinate or non-determinate, just let it all be exactly as it is. Of course, we're trying to create a determinate identity. So we think, well, we got a lot of work to do, because a lot of, loose threads, a lot of the things we need to still determine. And I know I've, graduated from school here and there. I got a little bit of resume that determines my identity. These are things I've done that have been determined. But I've got a lot more I got to do to determine. And just leave everything. All without trying to add any determinacy whatsoever anymore. Or to remember anything that we may have done. Or to claim anything. Or to protect or defend any determinacy we might have ever think we've done. Shift into this indeterminacy, this perfect, beautiful indeterminacy, and see how everything is abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness. Yet everything is just a display. There's nothing that needs to be determined at all. However we want the dance of display to appear, we can have that appear. It's not determinant of anything, because it could be any other display as well. Display is not crystallized, never crystallizes. In spite of sensory perception seeming to indicate that it does. Jesus calls sensory perception blindness. Can we ever make display permanent? Well, actually, all display is already permanent. It's already eternal. Every last thing, all display, no matter what arises, that too is eternal. Because the option, the potentiality for that to arise is never ending, it's eternal. So everything, all display is eternal already. Everything that we see, everything is eternal life. Creativity adorning itself. So you could say everything is already completely determinate. Also, we could say that there's the indeterminacy of whatever we want to arises. There's also the perfect determinacy that whatever arises is already present, has already been present as eternal idea. And will always be present that way, whether it arises as display, manifest or unmanifest. Everything, all is eternal. Everything is determinately eternal, right now. This is always the case here. It's always already present here. Everything is eternal life right now. So where is their causation? If everything's already eternal life, where is their causation? Where is their what we call process? Our determinancy. Hasn't everything already been determined? Didn't God create in a perfectly determined way and give us freedom to then experience whatever, any of this and all of this whenever we want? Freedom to experience and maybe to co-create even more of this ever, I don't know how to put it, but it's beyond our grasp. So we don't advance too much with this idea, but we don't retreat too much either. We just kind of hang out with it. This is the key. Just hang out with the practice. Some call it vision of equality, vision of oneness, everything intrinsically the same in its eternal life abidance. So the question is, well, how do I make this vision determinate? It's already determinate. It's already determined. The nature of reality is already, from the very beginning, it was determined. That there would be this indeterminacy, pure indeterminacy in terms of nothing actually crystallizes. Such that it's somehow requires some process to be for the display to flow into some other display. It's everything is flowing and free in terms of display. But don't think about it. Don't think about it. Don't think about it. Don't think about abidance. Just say abidance is completely indeterminate. And in its perfect indeterminacy, that is determinate. It's determinately indeterminate. Those who are trying to build some sort of determinate identity from the belief in crystallization of display, they want it explained. They say, well, I feel unstable. I'm having trouble stabilizing myself. The self is stably free. All is determinately indeterminate. So the thing is, this is not trying to make anything out of this so much as just hear it. Don't just need to say yes or no. Leave all yesing and knowing just as it is. Don't try to make any determinations about, well, how close am I? Without trying to make any more determinations about how ready I am, how close I am, how clear I am, whatever. Just drop all of that where, see, it doesn't really matter one way or the other now. It doesn't make any difference. This is the rebirth. This is the born againness. And you will find yourself getting a little bit of motivation that suddenly arises, and you feel like, oh, I can almost, yeah, I feel like I'm almost, you know, I feel, yeah, okay, I'll do this. For me, I start to, like, I can feel shaking and trembling a little bit, like, wow, this is really very intrepid. But don't push it. And then just settle into that. Say, oh, I do have this resolve, to leave all resolve just indeterminate. We don't have any more. Whatever our portfolio is, just leave it as it is. And then we step into this portfolio of what? Of everything. Portfolio of eternal life. All possibilities already present as pure potential, instantly present. So aren't they not present? Whatever we want to emphasize in our experiencing seems to take, you know, seems to come to the forefront of our attention, but everything else is available as well. just hang out with it. The longer we can just hang out with this, the better it is for us. Unless there's diminishing returns. Just don't be any hurry one way or the other. And we're kind of like in a calm ocean where we got our sail up, and we have it up, the sail, and we're just looking for a little breeze. Maybe our sail will catch a little breeze, a little puff of resolve, and the ship will just, you know, glide a little bit like that. Just okay. We have confidence. The breeze will come. The breeze of resolve. In fact, we say the breeze of resolve can arrive. The breeze of resolve will arrive. The breeze of resolve has finally arrived. It's already arrived. So we leave the dream of trying to establish determinacy. With all its so-called impermanence. And just let that dream play however it wants to play. It doesn't matter, does it? That entire dream is just a little drop of in the great perfect determinacy of all freedom is always present. Everything that's always being eternal life. It's just a little tiny drop. But leave any determinant explanation. Leave that also. Don't worry about that. Let that go. Go beyond the words to the experiencing. We can do it. We will do it. We've already done it. The breeze is already here. So just hanging out at the edge of this is very helpful. It calms us down. We get calm about it. And we look at the water and we say, well, I can get in the water. I will get in the water. I'm already in the water. Look at it that way. On the edge of a swimming pool, we say, I can get in the water. I will get in the water. I'm already in the water. Use the power of your imagination to imagine that. I'm already in the water. can get in the water. I will get in the water. I'm already in the water. I'm already in the water. In fact, we've always been in the water. We've just been hallucinating that we're sitting on the side of a swimming pool, thinking about getting in the water. But because we're so used to that, we go ahead and use the convention of imagining that we're sitting on the side of a pool. I can get in the water. I will get in the water. I've already gotten in the water. I got new earplugs today. I went to the moldable putty ones. And they say, don't roll it up so it's skinny and then stick it in your ear canal. That's what I've always done. And they say, don't do that. I said, what? How it's going to work? So I decided to just mold it kind of flat, like a flat ball, then just push it in. Oh my gosh, that worked a lot better. And on the outer ear, it's stuck in the outer ear. And for some reason, it has more surface area to stick to. And it blocked everything beautifully. I said, oh, my, all these years I've been doing it wrong. Oh my gosh. How many years have I been doing it wrong? Now the ear, the band, the ear that goes over the ears, it doesn't keep water out. What it does is it keeps the plugs firmly in your ear. And doesn't allow a whole bunch of water in, but water still, you know, water gets wherever it can get. Go, that's for sure. The slightest little crack, the water's in there. So that's pretty exciting that finding out, putting on the outside, outer part. Don't try to stuff it down the ear canal, because that just didn't seem to work. It keeps wanting to loosen up. I said, wow, okay. This needs to be emphasized. So I don't know. Maybe, you know, I could be in the pool, literally. Also here in the world, get in the pool. So as much as possible, just tell yourself, I'm already in the pool. Imagine yourself there. Feel that you're already in the pool. And just concentrate on that. We know that Longchenpa is making his push now, so we know something's going to happen, for sure. Something tremendous is going to will happen. So we're just practicing with that in mind, right? We want to be sure we're up to speed, right? Of course we do. Light is starting to diminish now. I'll just bump this all up. Pull this into more of a mode like this. And see if we can, how we can do. It's still showing up as blue. It's actually green. I don't know if I can get it to appear green or not. Doesn't really look like it, huh? Okay. It's not going to shift it way down here. And this is into the blue spectrum. Like, now. It's real dark, dark green. Oh, okay. That nailed it. And now, oops, that went back to blue. Too much blue. Let's see this. Going back to where it was green. See if we can get it right. There we go. Yeah, okay, now we're seeing it as it is. Period. Dark green and light green. Just tell yourself it's a fait accompli. I'm in the pool. And full stop in the wow. Don't have any more thoughts about it. I'm already in the pool. So this is where full stop on the wow comes in handy. In our practice, we can practice twilight. Past 8 o'clock now. So just stay very still. I'm already in the pool, but I'm just remaining very still, not moving. Not even thinking about moving. Like a newborn child, just be very quiet and just rest. Everything entirely still here right now. I'm in the pool now. This is intense, serious focus. Committed focus. if you may be drifting out of this intense assertion that I'm already in the pool and experiencing it as if you were, then wow that success that you've had. Go into the full stop and the wow of that tremendous success experience. The wow of that. Wow. I'm able to focus like that and be so intent upon it. Like a rebirth. So you see now how useful, if you can full stop on the wow, how you're willing to go into this rebirth and not worry if it gets, you know, when I get feeling like, oh, I can't, you know, maybe I'm drifting out of it. Well, I can go right into full stop on the wow. Then everything's fine. Everything is fine. I can lighten this up. It's all fine. It's all good. Just full stop in the wow. Now, when we wow it, we normalize it for ourselves. Just there's just been like a normal, calm experience for us. That I have a continuity with it. I was doing nothing before. I'm doing nothing now. Very nice continuity. Just sitting here, still sitting here, before, during, and after. And it's the willingness to put in the time here in Tarsa, in terms of getting familiar with it, which is, that's what's so valuable, so helpful. It's not an intellectual accomplishment. It's like a patience accomplishment. It's like a sweat lodge thing. You can't intellectually say, okay, I understand sweat lodge thing. You have to do it. Get through the patience of it, the focus of it. So practice just like this, unless you have your own, variation, whatever it is. How are we doing here? 155, 3 gigabytes. That's pretty good. What better way to honor the Dharma kings like Longchenpa than to practice like this for a couple hours today? You must be quite delighted at this. Say, ah, see, that's how it's done. Don't make the practicing we did determinant either. Don't make that determinant. Let go of that as far as determinacy goes. So, this is the best we can do as far as practicing like this, in this way. And we just stay calm, we stay. Underplay the whole thing as we go forward. Stay humble, meek, humble, mood of repentance. We have a very severe problem of continuity, fear problem. So we just continue to patiently do our very best. At the same time, we're very alert and aware and expectant and confident. But we don't let that confidence run away with us. We have that Ferrari, we'd say, well, I'm not thinking whether I'm going to drive it or not drive it. I'm not even thinking about that. I'm just right here now. Just looking at it. Maybe get in, sit inside for a while. I'm not thinking about whether I'm going to drive it or not drive it. I'm just getting used to it, making its acquaintance. And we do practice periods like we just did. I'm already in the pool, or I'm already driving it. But we recognize, okay, so we're practicing that, and then full stop on the wow. We're not making any conclusions at all whether I'm driving it or not driving it. We drop the practice and go into the recovery phase. Whatever I did in the practice, I did. And so now it's just full stop in the way. I'm not thinking about what I did, how much I advanced, not thinking of anything. How long I practiced, what I practiced, it's all gone now. It's just in the wow of intensity was generated for sure. That's all that we realized. Yeah, this wow was generated. So obviously we practice very well, but we don't have to remember what we did. Now it's just getting used to that intensity, letting it smooth out, letting the continuity fear evaporate, just letting it all settle. Let it all settle. Just let it settle now. That's it. Nothing to have to do anything. Just let it all settle. When you're in the wow, try not to get drowsy or sleepy. When you're practicing, that drowsiness can come upon you and sleepiness. But in the wow, you know, keep yourself very, very, very strong-minded in this period of the wow. I'm not saying anything happened, I'm not saying anything didn't happen. Right? It's just kind of this neutrality here. Neither advancing nor retreating. But you have to be very almost aggressive about it, just in terms of stay right with it. I mean, they're advancing or retreating. Don't drift off in any direction. When we're practicing, we tend to drift off, and we catch ourselves, practice again, drift off, practice again. This is natural for our practicing. But in the wow, We don't want to drift off at all. And now we may, but we try to stay really determined. I'm not going to give any wiggle room. I'm not going to drift off in any way here. I've used the same razor for 5 months after I learned that trick of shaking all the water off of it, blotting it dry in a towel, and then turning it upside down and storing it that way so that whatever moisture still remains, it runs off the blades towards the base and not towards the tip of the blade. Whereas if you turn it, you shave, it's still wet, and you people tend to turn it, you know, with the blades down like that. And all the water runs that way. All the water, gravity takes it right to the edge of the blades, and then the water dries on the edge of the blades with all the minerals and chemicals, whatever's in the water. And it corrodes the edge of the blades, corrodes it. This is why then when you start do it this way, you start shaving, it's like, ah, you know, it's like, wow, what happened to the sharpness? It's just, that's why. So I've used the same razor cartridge for 5 months now, and it's still cutting with it. Still okay. You know, it's not as sharp as it was when it started out, but I'm not really complaining or anything like that. Really, still gets the job done. 5 months. Someone who spilled the beans on this had used a razor for a year. So this is what we do here. We go into intense practice, and then we cool down in full stop in the wow. We just allow ourselves to cool down. This is how we do it. This is what really works. And the more we do this, the more we're willing to, because we realize, oh, that, yeah, I can get into it and I can get out of it. And I know there's a cool down period afterwards, and I'm good at that. So I'm not so nervous about taking a real nice leap. I know everything will be fine. So this builds confidence. The way to go fast on the spiritual path is to build confidence. Not to try and force yourself, but to build genuine confidence. Don't use drugs to force yourself. Build genuine confidence. So tomorrow, you can go even further tomorrow, for sure. You say, I feel up to it, yeah. I can do this. And go genuinely go further rather than just spinning your wheels, relabeling the same, you know, sitting on the edginess. So developing confidence is how you go the fastest on the path. This is why, for instance, you know, Tibetan Buddhists, for instance, constantly are reaffirming their confidence in their teachers, because they're building their confidence up. This is very important, to build your confidence up. We do it here by full stop in the wow. Realizing, hey, I can do this. I can, no matter what I experience in the practicing, I can just full stop with that. Like a huge bell, no matter how loud the bell is, I'm still just sitting here. I can just sit here and not move. However loud the bell gets rung, I have the discipline. Now, all is indeterminate. We'll flip the script a little now. Let's say I was looking at pictures of mountain goats yesterday, and precarious, they're perching on these just tiny ledges, and precarious positions. They can just stand there like this calmly. Well, if all is indeterminate, isn't the ledge also indeterminate? And isn't the space that you would fall into also indeterminate? So where's the ledge, and where's the space, and where's the danger actually? Is there really any danger there at all? If we want, the mountain goat could be walking on flat land. The ledge can just instantly be flat land. Or the space just be water. Or just buoyancy. There's no determinate situations at all. How can we be endangered? If we say someone made a determinate situation to endanger us, we're saying that they must be determinate themselves. Fixated. fixated self. But if we say, no, nothing can hurt me because there's nothing that's determined at all, then nobody's making any determinacy. The form of a mountain goat's not determinate. If we think, oh, it's going to fall, well, it could just turn into a bird and just fly. Or a balloon and just drift. Or a hang glider. Or a puffball just floating on the breeze. How is display itself endangered? How is abidance itself endangered? The mountain goat falls. Where's the change in intrinsic spaciousness, abidance? Where's that happening? So if we're worth, if we're worth, willing to work on this, like this right now, it's a show of solidarity and confidence in Longchenpa and Jesus and all the Dharma kings. It's a, the Holy Spirit. It's a show of confidence and solidarity that we're confident that they're confident in us. They're very confident that we will succeed at this practice. So we're very confident we will succeed. Okay, well, we're hitting the 2. All right. So just stay calmly confident. Not trying to brag about it or shout about it. Just stay, you know. Not really thinking of what do I have to do, or I gotta do this, or I gotta do this, or nervous about anything. I know I can practice, so when I'm, you know, I will practice again. I'll practice again. I know that. So let's see how what the response now is from grace to this, and just go from there. So stay in this confidence zone. Okay. Very great. This is it from the 19th hole. Well, remember that we want to practice that we've already finished our round of golf. It's already done. We're already in the 19th hole. Already finished. Very great. That's it.